Moving on, I do have a couple witnesses I will be striking from my witness list. I have had a petition court. I'll strike Mr. Philip Weatherspoon. I strike Ms. Deborah Thompson at this time. And then finally, it's my intention, and I believe Ms. Coffey's intention, that she will be testifying, and we'll probably be starting this morning. And then I think we should probably make it known that she has been told consequences of that, and that this is her decision. She wants to testify or not. She has been apprised that again, well, she may have some charges down in Indiana at some point. And if she'll say here, maybe she's against her in Indiana. I believe knowing all this, she still does want to testify, but wants to inquire about that. Perhaps it might be prudent to do so.
Still everybody's intention to stay away from Indiana?
Right now, yes.
All right, anything to add?
Your Honor, we did prepare a second amended information. I provided a copy to Mr. Schulke, and I would bench file it at this time.
All right, thank you.
We are ready for the jury, sir.
All right.
Please be seated. The jury is now with us in the jury box. Members of the jury, good morning. I'm sure you all had a terrible trip over here. I know I did. But you're all here at a long time and in one piece. I'm happy to see that. Mr. Schulke.
Yes, Your Honor. Before I call my first witness, I think there's a few housekeeping matters that we should take care of. One would be admitting some items that were marked as joint exhibits yesterday, but I don't know that we're actually admitted. So at this time, I would move to the admission of joint exhibit 113, which I believe it has been called a letter from Jason Cochran. Joint exhibit 114, which I believe we're calling a coat of arms or a shield. Joint exhibit 115, which is a Jason Cochran safety plan. Joint Exhibit 116, which is a composition book, and the first page has a letter or a writing on it from Jason Cochran. Copies of that would have been made as well for the jury whose and when this item submitted. These are both by 116. So I move for the admission of these joint exhibits at this time.
Thank you. No objection, Ms. Powell?
No, Your
Honor. 113 and 116 are received.
And at that point, our call is from Maurice Beauchamp to stand, please. Can we grab Mr. Beauchamp, please?
Step forward, sir, all the way up here. Is he in trouble?
I don't believe so. I did talk to him on the phone. I think he's able to hear. We'll see how things work in here with the acoustics. Come on up here, sir. We'll stop right here. Nice to come with you, Commissioner Nolte, okay? No. It's nice to turn.
Could you please, Mr. Beauchamp, would you please raise your right hand and be sworn by the clerk?
Do you You solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give in this matter will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, to help you God.
I do.
You may be seated.
Good morning, sir. This is Mike Schilke. I've already spoken on the phone. They asked us some questions today. Are you hearing me okay?
Yeah, my legs are a little unsteady, but I've got some medical problems.
All right, then I think we'll get you in and out of here as quickly as we can. And I thank you for coming in with the weather today as well. So, can you please state your name for the record, sir?
Maurice Beauchamp.
Mr. Beauchamp, where do you reside?
17 Lawrence. Yeah, 17 Lawrence Street.
And where is that, sir?
Wolcaspian.
Okay. And what is the relation of that address to 66 Lawrence Street, Caspian? Is it close to 66 Lawrence Street?
I'm across the street.
Okay. You say, so do you know, or did you know Jason and Kelly Cochran?
Never spoke to her.
Never spoke to Kelly?
Never said a word to her since they moved in there.
Okay, how about Jason?
Twice.
Tell us about those times.
2 minutes one time when he was burning in a burn barrel in the back of his residence, burning brush little pieces at a time. He had a big pile there, so I went over there and I told him that right behind my house in the gravel pit there at the city of Caspian has a place for you can bring them and dump that stuff.
Okay. And when do you think that event occurred? What season?
I don't hear what you're saying.
Sure. When do you think that happened when he was doing that burning?
When did it happen? Well, sometime after they moved in.
Yeah. Was it close to the time they moved in? Or is it further away from the time they moved in?
I'm not sure.
All right.
It's been 2 years, you know.
I understand. Is there anything about the particular time of year that would jog your memory as to what when that was?
It was in summer.
It was in the summertime.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you. And how about the second time that you talked to Mr. Cochran? When was that?
I was out in the front yard, raking my yard, and he come walking by. He used to go over his fishbowl over to the pit. I guess he was fishing over there. And he used to do that I've seen him 2 or 3 times a week at times. He'd go over there and then he'd come back an hour later.
Okay.
And that's when I talked to him. And one time he'd be coming back and I talked to him about 5 minutes, and he talked about, said he had some medical problems, that he had cancer in the kidneys, and he couldn't work, and we just conversed, that's all we did, you know.
Sure, I understand.
That's the only other time that I ever talked to him.
Okay, now you mentioned you did not talk to Mrs. Cochran, but did you see her in the neighborhood?
Kelly?
Yes, sir.
Oh yeah, she used to mow the lawn across the street for Art Henderson.
Okay.
And that's, she used to do it regularly.
Okay, and you'd see her mowing the lawn out there, pushing the mower?
Yeah, she did it. She did it, and that's a pretty big lawn, and she did it all with one arm one day.
Okay, we'll get to that in a second. What, if anything, did you see, what, if anything, would Jason be doing while Kelly was mowing that lawn?
Well, it was kind of funny because he would be walking up and down the sidewalk, just watching her, you know, wherever she went, he would be watching her,
so,
paying attention to what was going on there, I don't know.
Okay. Now you said you saw her arm in a sling. Do you know how she injured her arm?
It was looked like more like a cast, okay? I think it was her left arm.
Okay.
Because she's mowing along her right arm.
All right, so presumably this would have been in the summer or fall when people were losing their lawn.
That was in the summer.
Okay. Now, again, do you have any knowledge of how she may have hurt her arm?
I have no idea.
Okay. Thank you. I don't believe I have any other questions.
Cross-examination, Ms. Paul.
Yes, Your Honor. Good morning, Mr. Beauchamp.
Morning.
How are you doing today?
Well, legs are a little shaky this morning.
You made it over here, though. That's good.
Yeah, right? I did.
So, when Mr. Cochran was walking back and forth on the sidewalk, did you talk to him and find out why he was walking back and forth on the sidewalk?
No, I've got a 14-foot picture window where my chair sits, and Art Place is right straight across. I could just see him doing this through this window.
Do you know if, you saw him walking to the fishing pit, right? To the Caspian pit several times?
Oh yeah, he walked by and, yeah, it's just cold.
And did he walk a lot during the day?
Did he what?
Did he walk a lot during the day to other places?
Once. He'd go over there about once or twice a day at some time.
Now, with respect to Art Hendrickson, he lives across the street from you, right?
Art?
Yes.
He knew her.
Right. Art lives across the street from you?
I can't hear you.
Does Art live across the street from you?
Yes, right straight across the street. They live kind of kitty corner.
And Art is an older gentleman, right? Is Art an older gentleman?
Oh yeah, he's 93.
Do you know if he paid Kelly Cochran to mow his lawn?
I don't. Did he pay her?
Right.
I had heard that she wouldn't take any money.
That's what you heard?
That's what I heard.
Did you hear that from Art?
Who did I hear that from? No, I didn't hear it from Art. I heard from one of the neighbors.
So you don't know if that's true or not?
No, I don't.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sir?
Yes?
Mr. Beauchamp, you're excused.
Okay, thank you.
Watch your step.
Oh, yeah. You're shaking this morning. I brought my cane.
Do you need some assistance?
Next, I'll call Trooper Brian Rosler, please.
Rosler. Please stand, raise your right hand, and be sworn by the clerk.
Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give in this matter will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
You may be seated.
Good morning, sir. How are you today?
Good, sir. How are you?
Very good, thank you. For the record, could you please tell us your name?
Brian Rosler.
And what is your occupation, sir?
Trooper with the Michigan State Police.
And what post are you out of, sir?
The Iron Mountain Post.
Okay. And how long have you been working for the Michigan State Police?
It'll be 5 years in June.
Prior to working for the Michigan State Police, do you have other law enforcement experience?
Yes, I do.
Tell us about that, please.
I worked for over 4 years with Wyoming Highway Patrol and approximately 4.5 with the Minnesota State Patrol.
Okay, so say Wyoming means state of Wyoming.
State of Wyoming, yes.
Okay, so those are Tom. We've done state. All right, so I want to take your attention back to September 29th of 2014. Do you remember, well, first of all, were you on duty that day?
Yes, I was.
And do you remember getting a phone call in regards to a well-being check?
Yes, sir.
Can you tell us about the circumstances behind that well-being check?
I was dispatched to do a well-being check at 66 Lawrence Street in Caspian. I asked dispatch for additional information, and at that time I was contacted by Officer Rickland of the Iron River Police Department. Officer Wicklund advised me to call.
Objection, hearsay.
Objections, hearsay. Are you offering us to prove the truth of the matter?
I am not. I'm just obviously against it. Yes, just understanding why he's called to the well-being check, sir.
All right. I'm going to allow it.
Officer Wicklund advised the call had originally come to the Iron River Police Department. The call was made by Laura Sartori, who works for Oldenburg Group.
Okay. And it'd be fair to say that Ms. Sartori had some concerns about Ms. Cochran to be Orange County, is that correct?
That was what Officer Wicklund related to me, yes, sir.
Okay. And then after receiving this call and gaining more information, what did you do?
I proceeded to the residence and attempted to contact Ms. Cochran.
Okay, and when you received to the residence, you arrived at the residence, was anyone there?
I attempted to contact someone by knocking on the door. I received no answer. I walked around the residence. I noticed that there was a dog barking inside and a light was on, but again, no one came to the door.
Okay, what'd you do then?
Deputy Spiavo from the Iron County Sheriff's Department also arrived on scene, and we attempted to contact some of the neighbors. Made contact with one neighbor who said that he had seen Ms. Cochran's husband leaving the residence earlier and presumably he had gone fishing. That neighbor indicated that he had not seen Kelly Cochran.
Okay, and then what did you do?
Drove through the neighborhood, attempting to locate Mr. Cochran. We went to the Caspian Mine Pit, which is a common fishing area in that area. Made contact with one subject who was not her husband. There was another male subject walking through town, contacted him. Again, determined not to be her husband.
Okay, and then what happened?
Deputy Schiavo obtained Ms. Cochran's cell phone number from Ms. Sartori. I attempted to contact Ms. Cochran using the cell phone number. Received no answer. Left a voicemail for her requesting she contact me. Did not receive a call back that day. Went on to some past days, and upon returning to work, I believe it was October 3rd, received a voicemail from Ms. Cochran.
Okay. And what did she say in that voicemail?
She stated she was fine and thanked us for checking in.
Thank you. I'm not further.
Cross-examination?
I have no questions, please, sir.
Thank you, sir. You're excused.
Next to the defense appeal, Kelly Cochran.
Ms. Cochran, would you please stand, raise your right hand, and swear?
Do solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give in this matter will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, to help you.
Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you today?
I'm here.
All right. Well, first of all, for the record, you tell us your name.
Kelly Marie Cochran.
And Kelly, why don't you tell us a little bit about your background, tell us about yourself.
I am 34 years old, the oldest daughter of Melanie and Timothy Gaboyan. I've got three siblings, the oldest. I have some education background. I graduated from Maryville High School in 2000. Graduated from Purdue University Calumet in 2013 with a Bachelor's of Liberal Arts.
Okay. And what was that? What was your specialty at Purdue?
Psychology and sociology.
Okay. Did you have any other, like a minor or anything like that?
I did forensics and also Spanish.
Okay. So you're from Indiana originally. Tell us just briefly a little bit about the area that you grew up in.
I grew up in, technically it was Maryville, Indiana. It was later on annexed to Holward, Indiana, same street. It's, I believe the population is 70,000, so it's a lot larger of an area than this. Busy area. Grew up pretty basic upbringing, raised animals.
Now, at some point, you met a gentleman whose name is Jason Cochran. Tell us how you met Jason.
Jason had been my neighbor since I had moved into the house on Mississippi Street in Maryville. I've known him all my life. Our families pretty much, you know, talk together. We had cookouts together.
Okay. And growing up, did you Hang out with Jason?
Not as much when we were younger. There was a 4-year difference. He's 4 years older. We hung out, I would say, in my teens. It would have been awkward for him to hang out with me like when he was, you know, when I was younger. So we hung out maybe 15, 16. We'd sit by bonfires and stuff, more so later.
Okay. And eventually, this hanging out became a romance. Would that be fair to say?
Yes.
All right. And tell us about that. How long did you date? Obviously, you eventually became married. Tell us a little bit about your early relationship, Mr. Cochran, romantic relationship.
We had started dating in, it would have been 2000, I believe. Yeah, 2000, I graduated from high school. We had hung out a little bit before that, once at some concerts, but nothing ever really intimate, because he did have a girlfriend at that time. We had started dating, I believe it was in May of that year. We didn't date very long. It was 2001. We didn't date very long because we knew each other for a long time. We'd hang out. I was actually staying over at his house quite a bit when he was living on County Line in Porter County.
Okay. Eventually, got married, obviously, correct?
Yes. We got married September 14, 2002.
Okay. And how was the honeymoon period? How was the first 2 years of marriage?
First 8 months were great. He was perfect.
Okay, things changed after that?
A little bit, gradually. At the start, things were, like I said, great. He was, I would say, like my soulmate. I mean, we could finish each other's sentences. We did a lot together. We did everything together. After, I'd say, about 8 months, things got a lot more difficult. He would get angry easier. There was more like a second side. He still had his good points. He still was good, but there was still a little more to him on the other side.
Okay, this bad side, things continue to get worse?
Me personally, I've always been strong, stubborn, independent, feisty. I've always had to, try and, be independent. I learned that from an early age, and I don't know if he really liked that much. I don't think he liked that at all.
All right. Well, why do you say that? Would he do things to show that he was his displeasure?
He tried to, tighten the reins a little bit. I guess is the best way to say it. He would monitor most things that I did. It wasn't as bad at the start as it was in the last 4 or 5 years.
Okay. So, ever during this period of time, did he become abusive with you, or hit you, or?
In the beginning, it was just verbal abuse. I think that was actually the worst at the beginning. He had pushed me, shoved me, he'd gotten mad. I mean, we'd had some times where we'd yell at each other, and like I said, I'm feisty, and we'd have our yelling and screaming at each other, but there was a lot of times where he would grab me and push me, shove me. It got worse in the last 4 or 5 years.
We'll get there in time. Now, during this early period, did you have any concerns about his mental health based off your experiences with him?
I want to say yes, but on the other hand, I was, I think, a little bit too close. In my belief, I believe he had some issues. I believe he had some issues in the form.
Okay. Now, when he was verbally abusive with you, would he do that in front of other people, or is that something that maybe behind closed doors?
Mainly in front of me, but he did say a lot in front of my younger brother, Colton.
Do you think a specific incident where something may have happened that you were there and Colton was there as well?
In 2007, things were getting worse. We had separated in the fall of that year, 2007. I had asked for a divorce. I wanted to be done. Things were, at a boiling point. Colton was kind of, Colton was always there. You know, it kind of took him under our wing, just, you know, he was the youngest, him and Jason, and we did a lot more things together. But he had, he said he'd kill me if I ever wanted a divorce, many times. He wasn't going to let me know. He had thrown stuff, he had slammed doors, broken things in front of Colton.
Did he ever harm Colton?
No, not that I'm aware of.
How about animals? Do you ever have any pets with him while you were together?
Yeah. I've always had pets. He grew up on a farm. We had one dog, Sadie. She was a little pain in the butt, but you know, she's still a loving dog. She'd get into the garbage, and there was a couple occasions, one that was really bad. He had beat her, and he had put her into this garbage can, and beat her while she was in the garbage can, and then he put the lid on and left her in there.
And you saw him do this?
Yeah.
Is there any other time you saw him maybe harm an animal?
There was a couple other times. We were at a pool job a couple years later. He had, there was a cat that, I think it was in heat. I didn't have cats growing up, but the way it was acting, he was in heat. And he, I guess it was bothering him. He ended up drowning the cat in the pool, covered with blood.
Do you ever see him or hear him threaten another person?
Yeah, he's threatened quite a few people. One would be a friend of mine, Phil.
And you were able to witness this threat?
Yeah, he had threatened him a couple times, but I witnessed one.
Tell us about the time.
Phil and me had a friendship relationship. I kept contact with him. Jason did not want me to talk to him. We had went skydiving together. I think he was pretty jealous of that. He had threatened him. He said he would kill him if he didn't leave me alone, and if he contributed to me using drugs.
We've heard a lot of testimony about you've used drugs in the past.
Yes.
I've jumped ahead a little bit, but tell us a little bit about that. What your drug usage?
I've used drugs a lot. There wasn't really one certain kind of drug I've used. At the start, I just smoked marijuana, just as a, you know, I guess just once in a while. When things got bad, I started using pills a lot. I was depressed a lot, so I took a lot more pills. I'd experimented with pretty much any kind of drug you can think of.
Okay. When you said when things got bad, what would you mean by that statement?
When things got bad in the house and at home, I started using drugs a lot more to numb those feelings, put a temporary relief on what I was going through.
Okay. When did things really start getting bad, if you could tell us, pinpoint out?
2011, January.
What was going on then?
Jason had stopped working in 2011. His issue was his back. He had a back issue once in a while, which caused him to not be able to work. He stopped working from that point on. He didn't work from 2011 really until, he didn't work. I mean, once in a while he would do stuff, but that was it.
You say he has a bad back, but is he an invalid? Is he able to still do things?
He was able to do anything. He wasn't an invalid. When he was diagnosed with sciatica, which would cause pain, you know, the nervous pinch in his spinal cord, which would go down the left side of his leg, which would cause pain. I'm not saying it didn't hurt, but he was still capable of doing pretty much anything anybody else can do.
Give me an example of some maybe a project in the yard you would do or something like that.
He didn't do too much outside because he filed for disability and didn't want anybody to see it. However, there were times where he took our dog Bam out. Bam was 100 pounds, and she liked to drag people through the yard, which was being playful and a puppy. But he'd carry stuff. I mean, he can carry food.
So after we started working, did things got worse, as we said? Can you give us an example of something that may have happened after how things got worse?
Things got worse because I don't want to, you know, say healthy things because to this day I still don't know. But he was angry. He was jealous. I was out, I was leaving the house every day. I was working 7 days a week. He became very jealous, very angry. There was times when he had threatened me in the house, outside of the house, throwing stuff at me. I mean, do you want specifics?
Yes, sir.
There was a time when we were living in Mississippi Street. This was 2008. He was very angry. He had a 30-06. Anytime we had guns in the house, they were loaded. We had a fight. This was another thing of the jealousy. And at this time, I had no other relationships, wasn't seeing anybody else. He put the gun to my head. We were having our screaming and yelling. And yeah, I was still arguing back with him. And he pulled the trigger. And I don't know if I was necessarily scared. I'm sure I was, but just the whole thought that, you know, he already had a gun in my head and he was going to pull the trigger. Gun wasn't loaded at that time. It was the only time it was never loaded.
I think you said this happened in 2008. Is that, did I hear that correct?
It's okay.
All right. Were there other times that he held a gun to your head or pointed a gun at you?
Probably about 20 times.
And I think you said this was the only time it wasn't loaded. Were there other times that it was loaded?
Yes.
And tell me about one of those times, perhaps.
Oh, one of the last times he had shot at me twice in the basement. He had shot 2 inches from my head. Jason was a perfect shot, a good marksman with weapons. He had no problem hitting his target. I think at this time it was more to scare me than anything.
And we've got to correct that together a little bit, but that incident you referenced, that happened up here in Michigan, is that fair to say?
Yeah.
Were there times down in Indiana that he took shots at you?
Yeah, there was several. He had hit one of the walls and a piece of the concrete hit me in the shoulder.
So, you know, it sounds like your marriage was less than a fairy tale. Is that fair to say?
At the start, I believe it was, but yeah. Wasn't no fairy tale.
Did you ever ask anyone for any help at all?
No.
Why not?
I would say pride, I would say embarrassment. I was brought up, my parents were very loving. They would, you know, they're still married to this day. His parents were married still to this day. I was brought up that you try and make things work. You try and, you know, if something's broke, you fix it and push through. You get through these things. I mean, because nothing is easy. If it was easy, I mean, there wouldn't be a divorce rate like there is.
Okay. But again, what would you do to deal with things that were going on? How would you cope?
Drugs.
Now, at some point, maybe skipping ahead a few years, you decided to move up here to Michigan. Can you tell us about when that was and why you all moved up here?
Yeah, we moved up here, moved into the house January 29th of 2014, to 66 Lawrence Street. Before this, we were having more issues than we had at home in Indiana. He decided that we would move up here. He picked the state because he was able to grow marijuana and smoke marijuana legally. He grew it at home in Indiana, but it was legal up here.
Sure.
I believe there are other reasons, but I can't be sure what it is.
Okay, so who picks Michigan? You or Jason?
Jason.
And how did you home in Iron County and Gaskin, if you know why it was picked?
We were looking for homes online. I think he found the house on Craigslist, one of the online sites. He had picked a few of them, and he had sent me up here to look at them, and I met with Jeff from Uberlin Realty.
Okay, and you decided that this was the home?
It would work, yes.
Okay. Now, you said, I believe, that things were bad at the time. Right before you moved up here, can you give me an example of something that may have happened that was bad, or a specific example of a particular event that occurred before you moved up here?
He would freak out every day. Like I said, I was done before I came up here. This was, he said he would change, this would be a different start, this would be, you know, this would fix the past, what we had went through to this point. So, you know, I don't think I believed it, maybe I wanted to, He was getting worse. He had thrown me down the stairs at 7195 Mississippi. He had thrown me into the bed. I broke my toe. We had some fights, and I yelled back. He wasn't the only one yelling, but like I said, I'm feisty. But
do you ever hit him back? I'm sorry. Do you ever kick him back at all to that direction?
No.
What do you think he would have done had you hit him back?
He would have hit me again.
Now, prior to moving up here, have you had any kind of affairs down with other men or women, I guess, in Indiana?
Yes. Not in Indiana, in Minnesota. I dated a guy for a couple days. I talked to him a lot beforehand, but we went on 2 dates, and he was from Minnesota. This was in 2009, maybe. There was one other when I was separated in 2007. I was dating a guy I was going to school with, where I wasn't living at home.
Okay. And that guy, where that guy live?
He lived in Indiana.
Okay, so you said you weren't from Indiana, you missed all that first.
Right.
Now, I think you told me that you moved up here hoping that maybe get a fresh start with Jason and maybe a new change of scenery would maybe renew the marriage. Am I characterizing what you said correctly?
Correct.
All right. That happened?
No.
What happened when you first moved up there?
He was more jealous. He still wasn't, he had no intentions of going to work. I didn't work for 2 months. I wasn't in a hurry to get back to work. We had money saved up. Wasn't in a hurry. So I was at home more. But then I, you know, started looking for work and started working again.
Where'd you find work at?
First place was Ace Hardware in Iron River.
What would you do there? Just tell us briefly.
Cashier, stock, make keys, cut glass, help with different projects.
Okay. You said that's the first place you worked at. That implies that there's a second place. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, that was the first place up here. Second place was Mr. T's restaurant in Iron River.
Okay, and what would you do there?
I was a server, waiting on people. I was working there evenings when I was working at Ace Hardware during the mornings.
Okay, at some point, though, you got a job at the Oldenburg. Can you tell us about the circumstances behind that?
Yeah, I applied at Oldenburg. End of March. That was definitely the kind of work I'd rather do compared to the other stuff. It was more hands-on, fixing things, building things. I got a call in mid-May. My orientation after the drug screening and physical was May 27th, 2014.
Okay. What specifically would you do? You said you fixed things and made things. I don't know if they do it. Can you tell us specifically what you would be doing there?
My job there was electrical assembly. We would, you know, follow through blueprints and, you know, put the electrical wires and connections, make connections on some of the mining machines and just put things together.
And you said you had a drug test there. Presumably you passed that drug test.
I did.
And so it would be fair to say around that time you weren't using drugs?
The last time I had used anything for the drug test was probably 6 weeks prior, and it was marijuana.
Why was that? Things going good, or what was the point in your mind when you quit using it?
I knew I'd have to take a drug test.
So how about these other jobs? Did you keep them as well at Mr. T's and Ace Hardware? Or?
Ace Hardware, I did end up quitting on, I want to say the end of June, I'm not for certain on the date, because I couldn't keep all 3 jobs, but I did keep Mr. T's and Oldenburg. Oldenburg, I started working 40 to 60 hours a week. And I was doing Mr. T's at night, and it was 2 months because I was getting up at 3 in the morning, working there until, you know, my shift was 5 a.m. till 3 p.m. You know, so I had to work from that time, and then I'd usually start 4 or 5 o'clock at Mr. T's. Mr. T's, I got fired from there. They said it was because of my attendance and for theft.
Okay. Did you steal anything from Mr. T's?
No.
You had some attendance issues though?
Yes.
Tell us about those.
I missed several days there. I told them I had a funeral I went to. I didn't go to a funeral. I went down to Indiana to do some side work for pools. I was making a lot more money doing that.
Okay, so when was that? If you approximate for me.
energy.
It's not.
I was done working there, I want to say it's a lie.
So I think the term is moonlighting or something like that, where you are told your employer you're doing something, you had something else going on, you're doing another job, is that correct?
Correct.
So you lied?
Yes.
Okay. So, at some point you're working solely at the Lowlander, is that correct?
Correct.
And that'd be, I think you're fired for Mr. T's July?
I'd say end of June, beginning of July.
Okay. Yeah, I think you told us a little bit, but you're working 10 hours a day at Lowlander, it sounds like?
Yes. Sometimes more, just depending on the day.
Some point, while Lowlander, you met Mr. Regan, correct?
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
I first met him on the day of my interview, which was the 22nd. He was in the one of six that did the hiring. That was the first time I met him. But I would see him in passing. He was in the military assembly, so that was the section right behind the electrical assembly. So, you know, he'd pass through. We made small talk through the... we ended up talking more in the same gym.
All right, and at some point, did you see him outside of work?
Yeah, we had actually planned before we had ended up meeting up, we had planned a few times to get together. I was leery. I was trying to, I knew it was wrong to be dating somebody at work. I felt uncomfortable. Some of the things with my relationship made everything, my relationship at home made things worse. But eventually, after we blew each other off a few times, we did. He ended up calling me when I was at the car wash one day before I was going to vacuum out my truck. We talked for, I'd say, 45 minutes or an hour. We made plans to meet the next day, which was the weekend, and we were going to go hiking at Lake Iowa.
Okay. You said you had some issues at home. Can you specify what your concerns were?
Yes. I ended up putting a lock on my phone. Me and Jason separated. We were living together. We were separated in, I want to say, May of 2014. We both agreed on it, but he wasn't moving out because he wasn't going back home. He wasn't going to show his parents he had given out the fact. I wasn't booting him out because I was sole sourced in him. Things were getting rough at home. The jealousy was getting worse. The anger and aggression was getting worse.
So you put a lock on the phone. Why did you do that?
Because he was going through my phone every time he had a chance.
And if you know, do you know why he was going through your phone?
He was jealous.
Well, do you have a reason to be jealous?
Yes and no. We were separated. We had agreed on seeing other people. But I was still married to him, so he did have a reason to be jealous.
No. To be fair, Chris wasn't the only gentleman you were talking to at that time. Would that be fair to say?
Right before Chris, I had talked to a guy named Ken. There was no relationship with me and him. We did go out to eat. We did go to a park and hang out. There was no intimacy at all. Right after, I want to say in September, mid-September, me and Eric Erickson started talking and hanging out. Eventually, we became intimate.
Okay. And we'll get there in a little bit, but let's talk about that first date with Chris. I think you said you went to Lake Iowa. When was that roughly?
I want to say the end of June, maybe. Maybe earlier. I don't know the exact date.
Right. So, tell us about that date. Hiking, what did you do at Lake Iowa?
We went hiking. For this trip, we both drove there. I believe he gave me the directions there. We met and we started going hiking. We went, I think it's called the Light Blue Trail. They're color-coded, but I remember that. We had hikes. You want all the details?
Just tell us what happened.
We went and sat on a picnic bench and we were talking. The talking led into more intimate actions.
Okay, so you have relations with him?
Yes.
At the lake?
At the lake.
Okay. And after that, did you see him again?
Yes.
Start to form a relationship with him?
Yes.
Okay. Tell us about that. How often would you see each other?
At the beginning, maybe three times a week in the evening after work.
Did that increase
Yes, there was many weeks when both of us were free, if I wasn't in Indiana or doing something else, it would be 4 or 5 sometimes.
But when did this become 4 or 5 times a week, if you can approximate?
A couple weeks later.
All right, so what were we talking here, your guess?
When, like the date?
Like the month, mid-month, or whenever?
Mid-July.
And that continued on for how long? Were you seeing him 4 or 5 times a week?
Until October.
At some point you had a little bit of a spat with Chris. Fair to say?
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Me and Chris really got along very well. We respected each other's privacy. The only time we had a fight was a lot of the guys would give him hell at work. We'd be seen talking together and friendly, but there was never be intimate, never showing affection at work. We were very professional in that. But we did joke around and talk, which I think some of the guys seen and, you know, put two and two together. However, nobody had come out and said anything. Well, some of the guys had, you know, said to Chris, well, we know you're dating her, or we know you have a relationship, and he got upset because he was a supervisor there.
Sure.
He sent me a text. You know, he was mad, he was pissed. He didn't want anybody at work to know about this because he didn't want to lose his job. You know, he wanted to have to show integrity. I mean, and this was not good.
And how did you react to in this text?
I pretty much, you know, told him, the guys ended up poking him until he admitted that he had a relationship. So he did let on that there was something more than just talking. But I told him I'm sorry, you know, I did take the fault for it.
And then what happened from there?
We made up.
Now when you're seeing him 4 or 5 times a week, what would you typically do? Give me a typical evening that you'd spend time together. What would you typically do?
I'd cook dinner. We hang out at, most times it was at his apartment. We have dinner, we have sex, we talk, watch movies.
Do you ever go out of the town at all, go to a bar or anything like that together?
No. The only time we ever went anywhere together, we went to McDonald's for a coffee. He had a breakfast wrap or something before we went somewhere. And then we went to, I think it's Happy Trails in Iron River for ice cream.
Did you ever go on any kind of outdoor excursions or anything like that?
Yeah, we did that kind of stuff, but it wasn't really, I think the closest thing to this area was Iron Lake. I think it's Iron Lake. It's sure. North of the area. It's close though. We did a lot of hiking. He had showed me how to kayak, but mainly hiking and stuff like that.
Well, it sounds like perhaps either you or him or both of you were trying to keep things kind of on the down low. Would that be a fair thing to say?
Yes.
Whose decision was that?
I think both of us.
Why, from your perspective, why did you want things to be kept on the down low?
Because I was married.
And if you know, what was his concern?
Because I was married.
Now, at some point in the end, I think you referenced it already, that you started this relationship with Mr. Erickson.
Yes.
How'd that happen?
We, on smoke breaks, we'd go, you know, we all, for smoke breaks, we get like, I think it was 10 minutes in the morning, we'd go out and smoke. Everybody would talk, you know, just shoot the shit out there. On lunch breaks a couple times, you know, he'd run with me when I'd go get a pizza, Mr. T's, or stop by the gas station. Eventually we ended up, I think I gave him my number, and we ended up hanging out outside of work.
Okay. And when would you typically meet him?
After I was with Chris.
So, give me just a typical day when you're meeting with Chris, and you're meeting with Eric, and you're working. How would your day go, basically?
I get up at 3 a.m., get ready for work. Some mornings I would fight with Jason. Some mornings I got out with, getting out of bed. I would do my shift at Oldenburg, be done about 3 to, anywhere from 3 to 4, sometimes later. After that, Chris got off about 4, 4:15. I'd meet him at his place. We'd have dinner, we'd have sex, or we'd watch movies, talk, whatever. Not all those things every time, but for the most part.
Okay.
And then me and Eric would either grab a 12-pack. He liked wine a lot, so we'd get a bottle of wine once in a while. We'd sit up at a lake, local, there was three different places, four different places we went and drank and hung out.
Thursday, you were pretty busy.
Yes.
And Thursday, you weren't home a whole heck of a lot, something like.
Right.
What, if you know, what was Jason doing while you were gone during all this time?
What was he doing, or what did he tell me he was doing?
What's your impression of what he was doing?
I guess he went fishing. He'd hang out with David and Todd Saylor. There was a couple that he'd hang out with in Gastro. But pretty much walk around town, look for me.
He expressed his displeasure that you're gone all the time.
Yes.
What would he say to you?
What would he say to me?
Yes.
How could I do this to him? Why was I doing this to him? I'm his wife. Why am I doing this?
Did he ever threaten you?
All the time.
What would he say he was going to do to you?
Said he would kill me.
Now, did he know who you were out with?
At the beginning, I didn't think he did. I think he originally didn't know the password to my phone. Somehow he got the password to my phone and found a way to get in there. Because he had asked me about a pot roast or something like that, a pork roast. And I'd never seen the message. I guess he got the message. I didn't. He erased it. So he did find out about Chris, I think, by that. He found out about Ken when he was going through the phone. At that point, I don't think it was locked, though. And then he had seen my text with Eric.
Is he happy about your text with Eric?
No.
Happy that you were with Chris?
No.
Now, at some point, you know, juggling three men sounds like it's a lot of effort, would that be fair to say?
A lot of effort and mess.
Yeah. Did you decide that you could carry on with that?
No.
What did you do?
Jason was getting a little worse. He was hearing things, seeing things. He told me he was talking to somebody that had never been there. More crazy things. Things that, you know, he wasn't there all the way. He was snapping.
Okay, you said he was hearing things. Would he tell you what the voices were saying to him?
Yes, to kill me, to kill himself, to hurt other people. He said he heard these voices all the time.
And you alluded to him seeing someone who wasn't there. Could you tell us a little bit more about that, if you didn't know about it?
There was a couple times that he had seen people. One time he had told me, Walter, one of the gentlemen that testified, that he was there and they were talking and they were playing games and wondered why I wasn't there. And Walt had never been to our house. I think he was just snapping, losing a little bit of reality.
So approximately when was this?
September.
Now, this time, was he being more aggressive with you at all, or?
Yeah, it was building. September was probably the worst it had been in a while. It had been bad, but September was the worst.
And what did you decide to do with the other two gentlemen that you were seeing?
I had talked to Chris. This is before Jason goes to the hospital. I had talked to him and I, you know, said I couldn't hang out as much because it was a lot. I mean, I wasn't sleeping much. My days were full. I was working a lot. I was being pulled in different directions. My own choice, my own fault. With Eric, we still hung out, you know, a decent amount. It wasn't every night by any means. It was a couple nights a week. But Jason was, I guess, keeping better tabs on me. At this point, I found a GPS on my truck.
Okay, let's talk about that. Did you find a GPS on your truck?
I did not.
How do you know he put a GPS on your truck?
He showed me a little CD, not that big. He had ordered this from Amazon and got shipped when I was at work one day. He hooked it into the power source under the hood of the truck. I had changed my oil. I had changed the brakes. I had done a tune-up of my truck, and I did not see this.
So he went on and said, hey, show me this. He said, I know what you've been up to, or something to that effect.
Well, he actually had done one better. He told me everywhere I had been. I guess with this disc, when you download it, it connects to that unit, and you pull it up on the computer screen, it tells you everywhere you've been, what time, it gives the location of everything.
So at this point, you decided that you're going to slow things down with Chris. Is that a fair thing to say?
Yes.
How do you react to that?
He didn't react to that. He'd been looking for a different job. And he was staying up later with me than he was normally beforehand, so it was okay.
Okay. Wasn't mad at you?
No.
Did you tell him any specifics about what was going on at home?
At that time, no.
Now, you said this was before Jason went to the hospital. Before we get to that, at some point, did your folks come up for a visit?
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Jason and my anniversary was September 14th. My parents surprised me and said they were going to come up for that weekend. They told me a few days beforehand, I don't know exactly what day, they were coming in the 13th. Of September, and we're going to stay the weekend. It was the first time they had come out.
What did you all do when they came up here?
They got into town on the 13th, came from Iron Mountain, and I think I met them at the gas station to get them to my house because they weren't familiar with the area at all.
If you remember which gas station, there's several.
The Holiday gas station, Rep 2.
Okay. And stayed for a weekend?
Yeah, they stayed until the 15th and then went home.
What kind of things would you do over the course of the weekend?
We started off at my house. They wanted to see the house. I had been doing a lot of remodeling because it was built in the 1900s. There was a lot of stuff that had to be changed. Showed them that. Took them around the area. We went to Bond Falls, Agate Falls. There's five total waterfalls that we took them to. Went to eat a couple times. Maybe went to Iron Mountain with them, I'm not for sure.
Okay. Was that a nice weekend with them?
No.
Why not?
Jason and me beforehand were fighting a lot. He was usually pretty cool around other people. This weekend was not one of them. This was one of the first times my parents seen how he actually was. He was upset with me. He was angry at me. I told him I still wanted a divorce. I was still trying to get out that door because it wasn't getting better, it was getting worse.
Did you have some kind of outburst from your parents or anything like that?
Yeah, they were staying at the American in Iron River. We were eating breakfast, having coffee, and he flipped out. My dad got upset. My dad always looks after me and tries to protect me, and I could see him very upset. I pretty much settled him down a little bit, and then Jason went outside. We were yelling in the parking lot, fighting. That went on the whole weekend.
What does flipped out mean? Like what specifically did he do? You say flipped out? What does
he started yelling, screaming, calling me names in front of my family, grabbed me out and went to talk to me outside. And I didn't want to. I wanted to protect everybody from seeing this, but it had been going on too long, and I don't know if I was glad or not for them to see it, but for somebody to see what's going on and me not to feel like it was crazy was a better thing.
And you said your dad was upset. How did you know that?
How did I know that?
Yes.
Just the look in his eyes. He had gotten up. He was pissed.
And did your parents say anything to you? What's going on here? Or are they questioning anything like that? Or?
My mom always tries to help everybody and make sure she keeps the peace. And she had tried talking to him later on, and I think she had seen that he was slipping away a little bit, to put it nicely. Dad said, "What the hell am I doing still?"
Parents were there, I guess I'll ask, what the hell were you doing? Why didn't you just say, I'm done, I'm out of here, I'm coming back to Indiana with you?
I have asked myself that a million times. They both asked me to come back with them. My mom pretty much begged. I didn't because I didn't want, I guess it was part of, I don't know if it was pride, I didn't want to be weak in their eyes. I didn't want them to see me fail. I didn't want them to see, me not trying to give it my all.
Now you mentioned several times, talked about getting a divorce. Have you ever filed for divorce in any kind of court of law?
Not in court of law. I did draw out the papers though several times.
And when was that?
It was right around that time. I think after my parents left.
So you draw out the papers. What did you do? I mean, did you go online? Did you come to the courthouse and ask for some paperwork?
I looked into what I needed to do on the legal part of it to get a divorce. I was told I could go online. I got all the paperwork. I filled all the papers out and I served it to him myself. I was going to give myself a divorce from him.
Whatever happened to those forms that you filled out?
Burned them.
You burned them?
Jason.
Well, tell us about that.
He burned them. He burned them in this big pot we had in the house that they used for making chicken dumplings. It was a huge pot.
Did you just find them one day and said, picked them up and threw them and burned them, or did you confront you?
No, I gave him the papers and I told him I was done. I told him I couldn't do it anymore and he lit them and burned them in the pot.
Now, after your parents left, how were things going with Jason's at that point?
They were getting worse. Probably the worst they have been in one.
What do you mean by that?
He was aggressive and angry all the time. There was no calm moments. There was no, you know, peace between us. It was just yelling. Everything I did was wrong. Every step I made was wrong.
Was the 16th of September particularly bad?
Yeah, it was probably one of the worst days. We had fights. It was the jealousy. I brought up the fact that my parents wanted me to move back, and I had actually considered it. I had considered it, every day. And I told him, I wanted to be done. He put a gun in my head. He was going to shoot me. He was going to shoot himself. He was going to just end right there. I ended up talking him down, I guess, and I took him, this time was to the Iron River Hospital, which is the Spires now. He was seen there, he went in there crying, told him he was depressed, he was suicidal, didn't say anything about anything else. They gave him Xanax. That fixed the whole problem. They gave him the Xanax, he was taking that, and he was still bad.
Okay, what happened then?
The next day, he was probably a little bit worse. He did the same thing, and me and him went back and forth, arguing, and I pretty much thought I was done. He said he was going to take my life, he was going to take his. He couldn't take anymore, he wanted to be divorced, he wanted to be done with life.
He wanted to kill himself.
He wanted to kill, yeah. And he made the point of bringing up the voices that had told him to kill me, to kill himself. He named off a couple other people, but main point was to kill me and you.
And his people either Eric or Chris?
He had said Chris and he said Ken again. He had actually went to Ken's house. He had found him on Facebook and looked him up. He knew he had four kids. He was standing outside of his house one day, I guess.
I know all that.
I guess research on the computer.
I mean, how do you know that he did that?
He told me.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know if Ken ever knew. I don't know if it was true or not. I don't know.
Sure. Well, what happened? What happens next?
Somehow we come to understanding that he's going to try and get help for real this time. I was not taking him to, I think it was like North Shore at the time. It wasn't Aspires, but the Iron River Hospital. We weren't going there again.
Sure.
That wasn't going to happen. So, went to Dickinson County Hospital on Route 2 out there. And he actually told them that he was going to kill me. He was going to kill himself. What could he do? He wanted help. And they said they were going to end him. They were not going to let him go this time.
They didn't just give him Xanax and send him home?
Correct.
What did they do?
They they got a social worker from North Point, I think. I don't know the name, but one of the social workers that came to meet with him to see if he would be voluntary or if he had to be involuntary, committed. He did sign the papers. He knew he wasn't coming home with me. I didn't care what the circumstances were, he wasn't coming home.
But he signed papers to participate in some mental health programming.
Right.
And what did they, what kind of programming did they give him?
They wanted to put him in, look, first it took a while because they had to find a bed somewhere. They said it's a hard thing up here. There's not many places for people like that. So they found one in Rhinelander, Wisconsin, St. Mary's Behavioral Center. They actually wanted me to drive him there. That was out of the question. So then they had talked to a transportation service and they had made arrangements to take him out there. So it was like 90 miles away.
Okay. So you were willing to drive him to Iron Mountain. How come you weren't willing to drive him over to Rhinelander?
I didn't want to drive him to Iron Mountain, but I knew if he left, he wasn't going to get help. I was not going to be in the truck with him for 90 miles.
Okay. And this transportation service, what was it? Law enforcement entity, or was it a taxi company, or what was it?
I didn't see him get in. I didn't even wait to chase him at that point. They let me wait in like a family waiting room, which is out in the waiting room at the emergency room there. They just told me when his ride was there, so I'm assuming it was an ambulance.
Okay. Well, so he goes over to St. Mary's. How long is he there for?
The 19-14 through the 22nd.
So, what was that?
5 days, I
believe. Oh, 5 days? What are you doing during this time that your husband's over at the psych unit at the hospital?
I'm doing the same thing I was doing. I was hanging out with Chris. We were talking more. I was still hanging out with Eric once. More so with Crystal.
Didn't you go see Jason at the hospital?
I took him close one day. And I picked him up when he was ready to be picked up.
Okay.
When I was there to drop off clothes, I was able to go into his room, which he shared with somebody else, and I talked with him and talked to his counselor, or I think it was his psychologist at that point.
So you're willing to pick him up. What changed? Why are you willing to pick him up and bring him home?
Because he told me to pick him up.
Well, again, you weren't willing to drive to drop him off. Feel that perhaps he's better now, or what was going through your mind that you pick him up and go the 90 miles home?
5 days isn't going to change anything. No, when you're at that point. His doctors told me the medication had regulated his voices he was hearing, the hallucinations he was having, he was sleeping instead of being awake 24 hours. They told me he was better.
You know, will you... You mentioned his sleep patterns. Were you able to observe him when you were home? Was he staying up all night? What was going on as far as your sleeping?
I didn't really see him sleep much. Most of the time I wake up and he'd be standing over me.
Well, that made you feel?
A little uneasy. Okay. Uncomfortable.
Now, you said you were doing what you have been doing, seeing Chris and seeing Eric. You didn't think it was more important to deal with your husband over at the hospital rather than run around with these two gentlemen?
No.
Why not?
Because I was done.
Did he brought him back home?
Yeah.
What happened after he came back from the hospital?
The medications they gave him, we'll say he was very sedated for a while. The hospital had told me that they would oversee his treatment and make sure he was following what he was supposed to do. There was one agreement that he'd come back to the house as if he took the medications that he was supposed to where he wasn't as much of a danger, and to seek the counseling that he was supposed to see and to be seen by a doctor.
Did he follow through with what he was supposed to be doing?
No.
Did he see his counselor, to your knowledge?
He's seen a psychologist in Iron Mountain 3 times. I actually went with him once because I said that we could try it, like a couples therapy there. Plus the psychologist wanted to talk to me and, you know, to see if any improvements were being made at home.
Yeah. How was medications? Did he take his medications to your knowledge?
He did at the start. He did, which was nice because I know he was sleeping. I wasn't waking up and standing over me anymore. He wasn't normal, but he was sedated.
You say he was sedated. What does that mean to you? Was he, I mean, not everything that means, I guess.
He was very groggy, very sleepy. He was sleeping more hours a day after getting back from the hospital.
Oftentimes we hear people say they want to take their medication because they don't want to be a zombie. Was he zombies-ish? That's
at,
what we're...
at the beginning, yes.
Okay. Yeah. Now, did you tell either Chris or Eric and or Eric about Jason being in the hospital?
I told both of them. I had told, first I think I told Chris. We talked about it on the 18th and then on the 21st. I was uncomfortable with it because we didn't really talk about our relationships outside of, you know, being with each other. And I felt more comfortable with him and I had to talk to somebody. I let him know I was very uncomfortable. I was getting scared. I didn't know if we should be, you know, seeing each other. I didn't know what was going to happen from this point. He told me not to worry about it.
Okay.
He was very comforting. I didn't know what to expect. So, you know, like I said, it was more of an embarrassment than anything because, you know, my life was falling apart on one side and, you know, trying to make it right somehow, trying to fix things.
How about with Eric?
I told Eric a little bit. I didn't tell him all the details. I did tell him that Jason was in the hospital. He had tried to kill me several times. That, you know, he had put his hands on me more times than anybody should. That he wanted to kill me and had tried.
So where are we at the timeline now? Approximately what's the date you were taking?
This is towards the end of September. Last week of September, first week of October. That I told Eric, I believe.
Did things change after that?
With me and Jason?
Yes.
Yeah, he quit taking his medication. He wasn't being seen by a doctor, and he wasn't going for counseling anymore.
How do you know he stopped taking his medication?
I would count his medication. Okay. He used to take his medication in front of me. He wasn't doing that. He told me he was taking it.
Did his behavior change at all?
He was back to the same person. He was still hearing voices. He was still being told that, you know, he should kill me and himself. He didn't want to live anymore. He was angry.
Okay. What did you do in reaction to this?
In reaction to him not taking the medicine?
And just decompensating, like a good term.
I was using drugs again more. I was trying to escape the way I felt.
Did you turn to anyone for any help?
I talked to Chris and Eric. One night, for instance, me and Eric were drinking. I think that night we went to Sunset Lake, Mason Island River. We had drank quite a bit that night. I think we each had a 12-pack that night. He had one as well. I told him some of the bad things that were going on with me and Jason. And I guess he didn't say anything right away. When we had left there, he wanted to come back to the house and I told him no. He ended up going to the house, pulled the car in front of the house, and we were arguing in the car.
Okay.
He had gotten out of the car, slammed the door, I got out, and I was yelling at him, you know, no, no, please don't, you know, just get back in the car. He was drunk. I mean, I was drunk, but he was drunk.
Okay.
He was almost to the ramp, and I was able to talk him into getting back in the car.
And when was this incident?
This was beginning October.
Now, you heard Eric testify. You were sitting right next to me. He didn't make mention of anything like that.
He was pretty hammered.
Pretty hammered?
Yeah.
Now, you also heard Ms. Mayatek talk about an incident. Is that to your recollection what she was seeing at the time?
That would be exactly what she was seeing. She said she heard a shot, but she said her window was open. He had actually backed up his car instead of going forward. Because you have Main Street, and then there behind their houses across the street, there's a little alley that comes out and goes back to Baker Street or something like that. He had backed up, and I think he backed into the alley behind their house. We had drove to, like, the other part of Caspian. I don't know the street name. There's just, like, a big sand mountain or just a mound. And he had pulled over, and, you know, he was going to walk over there. We argued a little bit, we got back in, and we ended up going to my vehicle. We called it a night, but I did follow him home.
Okay. And after that occurred, did you have any discussions with Eric about what was going on in his life? I mean, What happened with him the next day, basically, now?
He was late for work. He had hit a deer on the way to work, and he was late for work. He was said he couldn't have no more late nights, and I can imagine how hungover he was.
And again, how do you know that he was late and that he hit a deer?
He texted me.
Okay. Now, you said you had a discussion with Chris as well about Jason. Again, I guess that's the plaintiff attorney's decompensated. Can you tell us what Chris's reaction was?
I talked to Chris. This for him, it was the last week of September. Actually, this is probably the third week of September. And was telling him a little bit about it. I didn't tell him all the details. It was embarrassing here. I'm supposed to be this, you know, strong, independent girl, and not so much. He had given me keys. He told me I could come by anytime, that he wasn't worried, and that I could talk to him pretty much about anything.
He gave you keys?
Keys to the apartment.
Okay. Was this just a key? I mean, was a spare set that you had?
Yes.
Okay. Now, I guess we're skipping ahead a little bit, but it's a deal with it now. You told different versions about you gave keys, you took keys, you made keys. What happened with his keys?
He gave me a set of the keys to get into the apartment if I needed. I had the keys. There were many times when I'd go to his apartment for dinner, and he couldn't hear very well a lot of times. There was one time he was in the shower. One time I think he was dozed off. I never used the keys to get in when I knew he was there. I would always knock.
Why don't you just use your key and go on in?
Because it's just, that's just the way I was used to it. Just walked in and that would be weird. So I always made sure he came in the door, at least knew I was there before I came in.
Okay. What's up with all the other stories about the keys then?
Just lies.
Nice. Fair enough. Now I want to take you now to mid-October 2014. What was going on in your life?
Any certain day?
Well, let's start, I guess. I'm sure I don't have a calendar with me. Let's start, you know, maybe around the 12th, 13th, around then.
Okay. I believe I went to Indiana to do pool closings for one day. When interviewed by the police, I told them I wasn't out of state and didn't realize this until after the facts. So when they asked me if I was out of state, I told them I was in Michigan, not in Indiana. I was in Indiana.
Okay, well, why'd you tell them that?
Actually, I'd forgotten I went to down there to do pool closings. But in one day of pool closings is like a month's salary for anything up here. So I did the pool closings. I come back. On the 12th, I believe I talked to Eric. I think it was the 12th. On the 13th, Jason was having some back issues. He needed more medicine for his back. He had me take him to the emergency room. I dropped him off. I run some errands for him to get some things. So I text back and forth, or maybe call back and forth, and picked him up from there, took him to the pharmacy, and took him home so he could take his medicine and lay around.
So we saw a spike in your phone communication with Jason on the 13th. What was all that about?
I think that was just more of the text and messaging for just saying, oh, are you done, or whatever it was. I don't know the actual context of the messages.
How were things with Chris during the 12th and 13th?
I had blown him off. I had done that a couple times. With everything going on, this time I wasn't working, but I did still have the relationships, which was a lot. Like I said, not anybody's fault but my own, but the choices I made to be with them, it was draining, and very draining with Jason. So I needed a couple days break. So I blew him off. I told him, you know, my phone wasn't working. I didn't get his calls or messages. And
was your phone working?
Yes.
So you lied to him?
I did. I'd done that a couple times with the phone.
And why did you feel the need to blow him off?
Just needed a day off, a break. No, there was no reason. We weren't fighting or anything like that. It was just me. I didn't have any me time. And like I said, my own choice, you know. But, yeah.
Well, you said you weren't working at the time. What were you doing to fill your days?
I didn't work from, I want to say, October 1st on. To fill my days, I was doing remodeling, cleaning. I, like I said, did some side work down in Indiana, but the rest was just, you know, in the evenings, I would hang out with Chris.
Were things very structured at the time?
No, not at all.
Like you said, every day was a Saturday when your interviews. What do you mean by that?
That was actually Jason's interview. He said every day was Saturday, okay. Which was rightfully so. But it was pretty much the same for me. I mean, there was, like you said, there is no structure. I was, yeah, I went fishing more. I would go to the lakes more, but there, I didn't, I was used to working every day and I wasn't working.
Okay. At some point, you made some plans to meet up with Chris. Can you tell us about that?
Right. He wanted to hang out the 13th. Jason was home that day. We had talked about actually coming to my house for a while. I was upset that he didn't come over, but I understood that he didn't want him before because I was a married woman, regardless of whether or not he didn't want him. He was packing, and the apartment was a mess, which it'd been for about a week. And he's organized a little bit once everything in place, and it was pretty bad. So we didn't hang out the 13th. I told him I was sick.
Okay. We made some arrangements to meet up with, well, let's not ask that. Let's ask, you know, who's moving? How did you find out he was moving?
He told me he had full intentions of moving to North Carolina to be with his son. He had tried to, they had just started, you know, having a relationship again after, I guess, a little patch of not as much.
How did you feel about him moving away?
I was excited for him. He was happy.
Not mad that he was leaving you?
No.
Did he ever ask you to go with him?
He had asked me once.
And what did you say?
No.
Why?
Not only was I married, I mean, eventually I'm sure I could have gotten a divorce somehow. I had to fix me just for all the years and the stuff that I was dealing with, the things that I was going through. I needed to make me right, you know, make myself happy before I could be happy with somebody else.
So it'd be fair to say that, I think we use the term friends with benefits. It's kind of what you have going on with both Chris and Eric. Would that be a fair thing to say?
Yeah, with Eric, it didn't start off like that. We were just buddies, hanging out, drinking, you know, late hanging out. But yes, you know, we did have intimate relations after that.
And Chris, did you develop feelings for him?
Yes.
So maybe a little more than just friends with benefits.
Yeah. I love him.
Jones, I guess I don't know when you want to take a break or not.
Right now.
Okay.
So, members of the jury, you're excused to the jury room.
All rise.